HarperCollins presents Black Gold, How Coal Mining Made Britain, by Jeremy Paxman, read by Jeremy Paxman. Prologue. The Hastings is a roadside pub in the village of Seaton Delaval, a few miles northeast of Newcastle. The pub and the village are named after local landowners who've been granted land by William the Conqueror and become abundantly rich, mainly on the proceeds of coal mining. They had that instinct for survival which marks so many wealthy families with large estates. When they fell on hard times, they restored their fortunes through adroit marriage, after which they commissioned a fashionable architect to design them a massive stately home. Admiral George Delaval picked Sir John Vanbrugh, the architect of Blenheim Palace and Castle Howard, to build a magnificent English Baroque pile in the early 18th century. These families intended to impress, and in that the Delavals were successful. Vanbrugh's designs were his last for a country house, and are thought by many to be his finest work. Seaton Delaval Hall is vast, with an enormous central courtyard of almost 2,500 square metres between two symmetrical wings. It is one of the grandest houses in Northumberland. If they get that far, some of the 80,000 annual visitors to the hall are entertained by the mausoleum in the grounds, dedicated to a 19-year-old son and heir who died after being kicked in a vital organ while attempting to seduce a laundry maid in 1775. If they but knew it, there is a much more dramatic story to be found in the village outside the gates of the majestic hall. The families of the miners who worked in the new mine, which opened in the year of Queen Victoria's accession, lived in 360 gimcrack cottages, supplied with water which had to be carried indoors from standpipes. There was, of course, no internal sanitation either. The village had three shops, a tailor, a butcher, and a grocer draper. A few of the residents, the local doctor, minister, station master, and some senior colliery officials, had bigger houses, but the best of the miners' homes contained two rooms downstairs, with a ladder leading to an attic. Most of the mine workers lived five people to a house, and for those with large families, conditions must have been appallingly cramped. The 1891 census shows Edward Ranshaw, a 51-year-old miner, living in two rooms and an attic with a wife, six children, and two lodgers. Across the road from the Hastings pub is a branch of the local co-op, successor to the shop founded by the residents in 1863 as the first miners' co-op in Britain. It nestles behind a petrol station selling pork scratchings on the counter. In front of the pub, beneath a plastic sign offering Geordie tapas and live sport on the bar's numerous televisions, a middle-aged white man walks his two greyhounds on a leash. The pub doesn't look as if it's on a campaign for real ale pilgrimage route. But one Sunday in 1862, the place was besieged by huge numbers of customers. They had arrived by train, horse, carriage, and on foot. The pub, said a witness, was literally swarming with visitors, passages and staircases alike being impassable, and with a callousness that is positively shocking. All are drinking, joking, and enjoying themselves. The local police attempted to exert some sort of control outside the pub by erecting temporary barriers, but it was the weekend, the Hastings was the only licensed premises in the area, and the sheer number of customers was simply unmanageable. Nothing draws a crowd like the chance to learn details of a tragedy. The visitors had come to try to discover what was happening literally beneath their feet. 3 days earlier, between 10 and 11 in the morning of the 16th of January 1862, the second shift of the day had assembled for work at the colliery in the next-door village of New Hartley. The newly arrived miners were due to take over from what was called the fore shift, which had begun work in the middle of the night. Like most changeovers, it was to take place underground to save time and money for the mine operators, who did not wish to pay men for the time they spent being dropped in cages down the mineshaft and then walking or crawling along underground passages to the face where they were expected to chip away. The pit had been sunk over 15 years beforehand and had been an unlucky place from the start. Its predecessor had been closed in the 1840s because it kept flooding. But the mine produced good steam coal, and its newly rich owner, Charles Carr, all sideburns and waistcoat and with what was said to be the tallest top hat in the county, believed that with a big enough steam pump to drain water from the pit, the coal could be extracted and sold. The machine made for him was one of the most powerful in the entire northeast coalfield, and built by one of the heavy engineering firms which had developed on the banks of the Tyne in the wake of the coal trade. The main cylinder of the beam engine was over 7 feet across, pushing up and down an enormous horizontal girder over 34 feet long, made of cast iron and weighing 42 tons. Shortly before 11 that morning, with a tremendous shattering noise, it broke in two. Part of the beam, perhaps weighing over 20 tons, fell down the shaft, which was the only way into and out of the mine. The accident had occurred at the worst possible time, when the maximum number of men were underground for the shift change. It would have been easier to manage a rescue had there been, as existed at other pits, 2 mine shafts. But the owners had followed local practice and sunk only 1 shaft into the earth, about 12 feet across. The shaft was divided in two all the way down by a timber partition or brattice to allow the usual mining ventilation system, in which clean air could reach the men underground through a downdraft, while a fire was kept burning low down on the upcast side to draw in the foul air of the mine and release it to the surface. If the single shaft became blocked for any reason, as now happened, tragedy would surely follow. That morning a cage was being raised to the surface. Inside were 8 men who had just finished their shift, doubtless pleased to be the first to have completed their time underground. When they were about halfway to the surface, they heard a terrifying crack, followed by a roar, as the broken beam careered down the hole. Debris dislodged from the walls of the shaft and bits of lift machinery struck the cage, snapping 2 of its 4 supporting cables. 4 of the men inside the ungated cage were thrown out and plunged into the darkness below, as rock, metal, and timber rained down upon them. The remaining miners knew their friends would not survive the fall. The massive beam continued its descent down the shaft, dislodging rock, rubble, and heavy timbers as it fell. The rocks, rubble, and rubbish then jammed across the shaft, blocking access to 2 of the 3 seams of coal. 204 men and boys were now trapped underground. The fatal accident at Hartley Colliery sounds extraordinary to the modern ear. The Hartley disaster was bigger than most, but Britain had by this time a barely satisfiable appetite for coal, and it was fed at a terrible price in human suffering. For over 400 years, the fuel of a nation and empire was dogged with accident. "Close the coal house door, lad," sang the Tyneside radical Alex Glasgow 100 years later. "There's blood inside." Perhaps there were years when no one died trying to get coal out of the ground, but they were exceptional. After the initial paralysis caused by the shock, men on the surface at Hartley began quickly to organise rescue efforts. By midnight, rescuers had clambered down and reached the cage, where George Sharp, although badly injured, was saying that he wanted to climb down to help his son, young George, whom he could hear lying injured and moaning on the rockfall below. One of the rescuers put a sling around the old man, but as he was being lowered, he struck an overhanging piece of timber, was knocked from the sling, and plunged to his death. He hit the ground a few feet away from where his son had fallen. 2 other men from the cage were retrieved successfully, but the most heroic act that day came from Thomas Watson, a recent convert to primitive Methodism, who had himself lowered into the darkness and stayed with the wounded men on a pile of debris part way down the shaft. leading them in prayers and hymn-singing until they died. Watson was the last man to be brought to the surface alive. He had been underground for 11 hours. Other miners rushed to the stricken colliery to offer what help they could. Under the leadership of William Coulson, who, with over 40 years' experience, was considered the finest sinker of mine shafts in the Northeast, they worked on feverishly, but the obstacles were enormous. Great quantities of debris blocked their way, and often they had to line the walls of the shaft with heavy timber to prevent another fall. By now, word had spread across the Northeast that a life-or-death rescue drama was taking place. Over the weekend, the trippers began to arrive, and the Hastings found itself with a roaring trade. Among those dispatched to the scene was Thomas Weems Reed, a 19-year-old reporter on the Newcastle Journal and Courant, who began to keep an hourly account of what he rapidly recognised as the most terrible calamity that was ever visited upon any coal mine in the country. His writing is purple in places, but for the most part remains an object lesson in how to write about ongoing drama. Urgent, frank, emotional, exploitative, of course, yet dignified. On the Saturday, he noted how, around the pit buildings, a group of men are gathered, talking to each other in undertones, speculating upon the fate of their comrades. Whenever the gin, the winch, needs to be turned, they volunteer for the service, for the horses are thoroughly worn out with the labour through which they have gone. At other times they stand idly and silently, apparently quite unconscious of the bitter blast which is sweeping in from the sea with chilling force. Occasionally one or two women, with tearless faces, come from the village to know if anything has transpired regarding the fate of their loved ones. And then, with fixed, stony countenances, the sight of which is far more moving than any violent outbursts of passion would be, slowly return to their desolate homes. The appearance of the village itself indicates the presence of some overpowering calamity. Few villages are more noisy or cheerful than those connected with collieries, he wrote with some journalistic license. But here a deep and solemn silence prevails. No children are at play, every door is shut, and the one or two little shops at which the inhabitants supply themselves are partially closed. Through the windows can be seen the clean bed, which is always remarkable in the cottage of a North Country pitman, while upon the table in front of the window, in almost every case, the breakfast things prepared for the prisoners on Thursday morning are still standing awaiting them. Hour by hour, the reporter recorded the frenzied efforts and the false hopes. Someone had seen smoke rising. The trap men must have made a fire and could feed themselves on the dead pit ponies. "Hope at last, thank God," Weems Reed wrote in his journal at midday. Jowling had been heard, which was taken for a sign of life. It turned out later to be the sounds of rock and water moving. Helpful suggestions were coming in from across the country. A Mr. Hill of Bristol had suggested boring a small hole through the debris in the shaft and pouring soup down it to the men. Mr. Hill and the others who proposed this plan may rest assured that had it been feasible, it would long ago have been attempted, wrote Weems Reed. At 9 on Monday morning, he reported that digging was going better than expected, and another hour at the most, too, must decide the dreadful fate of the 204 prisoners. In Newcastle, some idiot in his newspaper's circulation department had placards painted with the words "Glorious News at Last." The truth was that those who had survived the accident to the cage had been poisoned by scythe or choke damp, one of a variety of gases produced when hitherto buried coal was exposed to the atmosphere. Deep in their hearts, the wives and families of the missing miners, most of whom sat up all night in their cottages, began to realise that their menfolk were never to return alive. At the pithead, Weems Reed heard suspicion sweeping the crowd that the survivors of the accident had been gassed. At 10 o'clock he wrote that the very heart sickens and the hand palsies, as we write these lines and anticipate a dreadful conclusion to our long and painful watch. At 4 on Tuesday morning, almost 5 whole days after the accident.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.